Welcome to our service for Trinity Five. From east and west, from north and south, God's people gather together in praise.
Glory and praise to God.
From dawn to noon, from noon to night, God cares for his people.
Glory and praise to God.
From sadness to joy, from death to life, God walks with his people.
Glory and praise to God,
whose love for us is beyond our understanding.
Thank you.
O God, your Spirit brooded over the face of the waters. Your word called forth creation. Your breath brought life to women and men. And it was good. Glory to you, O God, your graceful rainbow stretched across the heavens. Your cloud led the people through the wilderness. Your prophets proclaimed your ways. And it was good. Glory to you, O God. Your love brought Christ to birth. Your love led Christ to the cross. Your love raised Christ from the tomb. And it was good. Glory to you, O God. Your Son ascended in glory. Your Spirit came like wind and fire. Your grace gave birth to a new community. And it was good. Glory to you, O God. Your love has called us to worship you. Your Spirit leads us into new things. Your call sends us on. Glory and praise to God. We pause for a moment as we prepare to make our confession. If we have lost our vision of your ways, Lord, forgive us and renew us. Lord, have mercy. If we have closed our ears and failed to heed your call, Lord, forgive us and renew us. Christ, have mercy. If we have been fearful of new things, reluctant to step into the unknown, Lord, forgive us and renew us.
Lord, have mercy.
If we have forgotten the joy of the gospel and do not trust in your peace, Lord, forgive us and renew us.
Christ, have mercy.
May the living God renew your vision, give you victory over sin, and set you free through his forgiveness.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer, which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth, to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our New Testament reading is from Colossians 1. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might have come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his fleshly body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and my flesh I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the world of God fully known, the mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known how many great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Blessed is the man who walks in your favor, who loves all your words and hides them like treasure. In the darkest place of his desperate heart, I call out your name, but I cannot find you. I look for your face, but you are not there. By my sorrows, Lord, lift me to you. Lift me up to you. Against me, no one can trouble or harm me if you are my strength. All I ask, all I desire is to live in your house. Touch me and make me whole.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her." Praise to you, O Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our Lord and our God. Amen. The Bible says in Romans, "How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace." I don't know about you, but when I think about beautiful things, feet don't rank very highly on my list. Did you know that you have roughly 250,000 sweat glands in your feet? That's why they're so stinky. Madeleine Albrecht knows all about stinky feet. She got a job at a laboratory, a testing lab for Dr. Scholes. Her job was to sniff feet, and she did that for 15 years. During her career, Madeleine set the world record for sniffing approximately 5,600 feet. Our feet may not be the sweetest smelling appendage, but if the feet of those who share the good news are considered beautiful by God, then how much more beautiful are the feet of the one who made the good news so good? Joni Erickson, a famous writer and speaker in church circles, once shared a little story about a trip she took with her friends Francie and Judy to a medical centre. Joni was paralysed following a diving accident when she was just 17 years old. On entering the centre, they walked into a luxurious reception where a 25-foot statue of Christ towered beneath a four-storey glass rotunda. The sculpture fashioned Jesus looking down with his arms outstretched, as if bestowing a blessing. Simply awestruck, Joni lowered her gaze, realised just where she was, and then whispered to her friend, "It's good to be at his feet." Suddenly, an officious-looking man approached. "Isn't your name Joni?" he asked, introducing himself as the administrator. "I'm a Christian too," he said. "If there's ever anything I can do to help, please let me know." It was a generous offer, but after flying home, Joni forgot all about it. She forgot, that is, until her friend Madeleine, who was rapidly going blind, told her, "My specialist says that the only people who might be able to do anything are the medical centre where you went, Joni. But I don't know a soul there, and I don't think I could ever get an appointment." Instantly remembering what happened at the feet of the statue of Jesus, Joni made a call to the administrator, putting him in touch with Melanie, and the door opened for her. Before she flew for her appointment, Joni emailed her, "Dear Melanie, there's a statue of Jesus you must see when you go to the medical centre next week. Don't miss it. Amazing things happen at the feet of Jesus." She's right, I think. Amazing things happen at the feet of Jesus. And no one knows that better than Mary of Bethany. Nearly every time her name is mentioned in the Bible, she can be found at the feet of Jesus. In fact, the Bible shares three different stories about Mary at Jesus' feet, and each time, amazing thing happens. This morning, I'd like to look at the first time Mary is found at his feet. This time, she's at his feet listening to his word. My guess is most of us probably identify more with Martha than with Mary. So many sermons, articles, and books have been written about this poignant passage. My favourite is a book titled "Having a Mary Heart in a Martha World." That's what we all need, isn't it? A heart like Mary's, a heart that leads us to the feet of Christ. So how do we develop a heart like that? Having a heart like Mary's requires a shift in focus. Mary and Martha had a very distinct difference in focus. Admittedly, Martha had a lot on her plate. She just invited Jesus with 12 hungry disciples over for dinner. But she doesn't just make sandwiches, not this hostess. She goes all out. Forget about stopping to smell the roses. Martha has so much to do and so little time to do it. The Bible says Martha was distracted by her many tasks. If your family is anything like ours, then you've got a lot going on. You've got the laundry to fold, dishes to wash, children or grandchildren to care for, dogs to feed, church commitments to keep, socials to attend, lunch appointments, doctor's appointments, hair appointments, and that doesn't even begin to account for the projects, paperwork and priorities at the office or in the shop or on the farm. Have you ever thought that maybe God is calling you to slow down a little and take a deep breath? Maybe Jesus is trying to tell you what he told David, "Be still and know that I am God." It isn't easy for any of us to be still. It requires us to change our focus. While Martha was focused on her tasks, Mary was focused on her teacher. While Martha was focused on jobs, Mary was focused on Jesus. What amazes me is that even after reading this story, many of us are tempted to cheer for Martha. But while Martha was distracted by so many things, Mary had discovered the one thing worthy of all our attention. That brings me to the second shift necessary for having a heart like Mary's, a shift in fellowship. Martha had opened her house to Jesus, but that didn't necessarily mean that she opened her heart to him. In her eagerness to serve Jesus, she almost missed the opportunity to know him. I'm convinced that Mary will have been helping Martha with all the preparations until the guests arrived. Then probably after Jesus and the disciples made themselves comfortable in the living room, complimenting Martha on her lovely home and wrapping up the small talk, Jesus then began to teach. Jesus speaks like no one else ever has. There is a joy and energy about him, a magnetism in his words, as if they breathe life itself. And probably Martha, Mary, couldn't help but just listen to Jesus. She knew that there's work to be done, but she couldn't move anywhere except closer until she finds herself kneeling at his feet, savouring his every word. Somewhere in the distance, she hears her sister calling her name, but it's drowned out by Christ's words. Meaningful intimacy and fellowship with God will never come out of the busyness of Martha's kitchen. It can only be found at the feet of Jesus, which is right for Mary to be. How much time do you spend sitting at his feet, savouring his word? Your time with God, your time with Jesus is important, more important than anything else you have to do today or any day. The one thing that matters is Jesus, knowing him and experiencing intimate fellowship with him. The Apostle Paul put it this way: "I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage so that I could gain Christ and become one with him." If we want to have a heart like Mary's and experience real intimate fellowship with God, then we have to put the important things ahead of the urgent things. There will always be endless demands pressuring every hour of the day, but sitting at Christ's feet is the most important thing we can do with our time, because nothing is more valuable than getting to know Jesus. And when you do that, as you begin to develop this Mary-like heart, you'll notice a shift in feelings. Let me ask you, How do you think Martha felt that day? It's not hard to figure out, is it? She was stressed out over everything she had to do and angry with her sister because she wasn't helping her. Then Jesus even says, "My dear Martha, you are worried and upset over all these details." Maybe she was cross with Jesus too. You know what that's like, don't you? There is always a deadline to meet, even if you're retired. There is always stacks of stuff to do, and maybe your spouse or co-worker isn't pulling their weight, and so you get worried and stressed and upset. And it's no fun being worried and upset. You don't want to feel like that, and God certainly doesn't want you to feel that way. Unfortunately, for some, though, being worried and upset is a way of life. I know that because I've been there, even though I know the answer. But take a look over at Mary, sitting at his feet, hanging on Jesus' every word. Does she look worried or upset? Does she seem stressed? Could it be that Mary's choice to sit at Jesus' feet came with a soothing side effect? I'm convinced that the more time we spend at the feet of Jesus, the less we're going to worry about the little annoyances in life. In fact, the Bible says, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you." Jesus invites all of us to have that same experience. I have known several people who have suffered severely from stress, anxiety, and depression. Some of them still do. But I can tell you from first-hand experience that spending time before God has a changing life effect. I don't have time to tell you my story today, but one day I will. Amazing things happen at the feet of Jesus. I want to encourage you to spend some time at his feet, savouring his word. Get away from all the distractions. Shift your focus to Jesus. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Amen.
Sons of the earth, how beautiful.
In Christ, the people of God are called together in peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace in our homes or in our hearts. And so we pray. We pray for God's grace, saying, Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. Lord God, through your grace we are your people. Through your Son you have redeemed us. In your Spirit you have made us as your own. We pray for the life of our benefice. We pray for all who join us through our broadcast service. May our hearts respond to your love. Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. We pray for our world, continuing especially to pray for the people of Ukraine. And we pray for all those in areas of the world afflicted by famine. Make our lives bear witness to your glory in the world. Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. We pray for all involved in service, all who care for others. Make our wills eager to obey and our hands ready to heal. Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. We give thanks for all who have died, especially those whose anniversary occurs at this time. Make our voices one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Lord, receive our prayer and hear our prayer. And make us one in heart and mind to serve you with joy forever. Amen. And we pray together, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We have brought the gift of ourselves, sung our hymns, and remembered our God. As we go into the world, help us to live our lives and grow into the people you wish us to be, so that we may share, give, bless, and help through Jesus Christ, our friend and Saviour. Amen. May God's joy be in our hearts, may God's peace be in our world. And may God's love be known between us, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The sun that always lights the sky. May you always have great courage to spread your wings and fly. May you have a friendly greeting for those you meet along life's way. And until we meet again, my soul renews you. So let eternal light shine forth. Let all our hearts be entwined. Come, let the light of life the joy flow deep within you, and honest be the hearts of those you love. May your tender hand be open with guidance from above. May your passage be a safe one as you live your life from day to day. And until we meet again, my soul renews you. So let eternal light shine forth. Let all our hearts be entwined. Come, let the light of life burn bright in a heaven and now on until we meet again, and until we